Okay, good morning, everyone. Good to have you with us today. And before we get started, I want to wish all the fathers here a very happy Father's Day today. Enjoy your day, and hope you have a good one. If you would, let's all stand, turn to page 506, please. Page number 506, we'll sing all three verses. Yeah, good to see you today. Page 506, we'll sing all three verses.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, lost in his blood. This is my story.
Father's Day, so we want to say hello and congratulations to you fathers. Good to have you with us today. By the way, I think it's a good choice to come to the house of God. Amen. As a father, a good leader, and a good example, and so thank you. But we are welcome you and welcome you online. Thank you so much for joining with us today, and we hope and pray that God will be pleased with our worship of him today. Let's go ahead and bow our heads, word of prayer. Father, thank you today that we can assemble ourselves together. And Lord, the greatest Father of all, Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us and what an example you are to us. Lord, I pray that we will imitate you in our lives. And I pray, Father, that, Lord, you would get a hold of the men of our land. That, Lord, that we would get back to, Lord, walking with you and living for you like we ought to. And, Father, I pray that, Lord, our homes will be changed because the fathers have changed. I pray, Lord, for your blessing today. May you be pleased in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Welcome, everybody. It is good to have you today in the house of the Lord. Glad that you are here. We want to just remind you about a few things. First of all, we want to remind you to please keep in prayer. We have shared some prayer requests with you. and we want to just kind of keep them before you. Please continue to pray for Roseanne as she's still in the hospital, and just keep her in your prayers. Also, Bernie and Marie Martin, and with Bernie on dialysis now, and just you please continue to pray for them. I know they would appreciate it very much. Gary Ratliff, as he deals with cancer, I know that it's just an up and down situation. So I know he would appreciate your prayers also. Boy, it was so good. Today was our first day to kind of open up for Sunday school, and so we kind of took that step, and so it's a learning process for us to try to figure out how to do that and at the same time practice social distancing. And so we'll give you an assessment as of right now. We're going to do it again next Sunday also. And so, but we are learning as we go. So God bless you. Thank you so much for being with us. And I know that some are still online, and we're going to continue that, obviously, because there are those that cannot come to the house of God. Physically, they cannot come, but they are able to watch the service online, and so that's a blessing. And so with that part, amen. Obviously, I think if you can get here, you know, then you should come. Technology doesn't replace the Word of God. You know, it can be, though, a good instrument that we can use for His honor and His glory. We're learning as we go, and so be praying for us. We also, of course, just want to encourage you to continue to pray, obviously one for another, and just be encouraging to one another as well, because you just never know what people are going through. But anyway, we wanna welcome you here, and thank you so much for being with us. And Brother Dave's going to come back and lead us in another song. Before he comes, though, let me just remind you, we're not shaking hands and things like that, and as far as offering and all that, offering plates are up here, but we're not going to be taking an offering. So you can either put it up here in front, or there's a box back there by our missionary letters, and you can just drop it there in that particular black box, okay? So either way, just want to remind you about that. Brother Dave?
Okay, if you would, let's all stand. Turn to page 221, please. Page 221, crown him with many crowns. We'll sing the first and last verse.
Has died. Be thou, O Lord.
Bible says in Isaiah 55, 8, and 9, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts." It's not what I wanted. It's not something I understand. My circumstances seem so confusing. I'm placing it all in your hands. Your ways are high. I want mountains to move, you want me to climb, but I'm gonna trust your word, your will, and your time. Your ways are higher than mine. One day I'm sure I will look back and marvel at how you knew best all along. You see from heaven, you know it's the hard times that make my faith steady and strong. Your ways are high. I want mountains to move, you want me to climb, but you're gonna trust your word, your will, and your time. Your ways are higher than mine. When I start to doubt, help me believe. Your ways are higher than mine. I want mountains to move, you want me to climb, so I'm gonna trust your word, your will, and your time. Oh, your ways are so much higher than mine. Your ways are higher than mine.
What an acknowledgement that God is greater than we are. Amen?
Amen?
His ways are higher than our ways. He knows what he's doing. And you and I would do so well to acknowledge that and to submit to that. And amen for that. If you would, this morning we are in the book of Joshua. We actually started last Sunday and looking at one of the heroes of the faith And in this case, it is Joshua. And we'll be spending, as I told you, some time in Joshua. And of course, today is Father's Day. And so, because of that, we're going to jump ahead and look at Joshua 24. Let's all stand. Joshua 24, as we honor the Word of God, we stand in honor of God and His Word. And Joshua 24, and I'm just going to read one verse, and then we'll have a word of prayer, and then you may be seated. Bible says in Joshua 24 and verse 15, a very familiar verse for most people, anyway, that are Christians, that either been raised up in it, but it reads like this. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. Are you in the right place? Whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Obviously, that verse speaks volumes, but one of the things it highlights and emphasizes, and that is not only the family, but in particular, the Father. Being that it is Father's Day, we want to highlight that particular aspect of it. Thank you so much for coming today in the house of the Lord. And let's get started with a word of prayer. Would you bow your head, please? Father, thank you that we can assemble ourselves together today. And thank you so much for your precious word. And I pray, Father, that we will be challenged, will be encouraged, inspired to live according to your word today. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I know it may be traditional in the respect that it is a common message, but it is the message that needs to be always proclaimed, especially from the house of God, because it probably won't be delivered much anywhere else. And that is this, the need of our families and the need for godly men in our families. It is not a new situation, but unfortunately the family is greatly on attack these days, and though I'm not going to get into all of this, but the identity of the family, the definition of the family, all of that has been lost. And I tell you how important it is that the church continues to proclaim the message of God's word concerning the family. And I understand that maybe today you're here and your family just was all broken up and it, because of the sins of whoever. I understand that happens, does it not? But it doesn't mean, though, that God's word is wrong because of that. Just because you've had a bad experience and just because your dad wasn't a very good dad, that doesn't mean fathers are not what they ought to be, and that what God says concerning fathers. Amen. You know, you might be, well, preacher, I didn't have a very good dad. Well, fine, but then learn from the best father of all and be a good dad. Amen. That's the way it ought to be. And so, obviously, we have before us a very important statement from Joshua concerning Israel to the leaders of Israel. And I'm not going to give you much background. Most of you know what it is for sure. But the challenge was to Israel was to continue on and serve God. Don't give up. Don't quit. Joshua knew that his days were numbered and he was getting to the end of his days. And God had done what he said he would do, did he not? In other words, he blessed Joshua. And all the days of Joshua, they served the Lord. But as Joshua was looking down the road, and because he knew that his time was going to end, he was concerned about Israel. And he challenged them, choose you this day whom you will serve. And I do believe that every single family and every single individual must make that choice. I believe today is no different. That we are at a time in our life where we've got to choose who you're going to serve. And the ideal is this, would to God that, and I don't think Joshua was saying, well, it's okay, you just serve whoever you want to. I don't think he was saying that. Without a doubt, Joshua was leading Israel to serve God. But the truth is, though, it is a choice. And you and I must choose to do that. Well, this morning, I'm so very thankful for what God has said concerning his word, concerning families and all. And I hope and pray that we might be a blessing to you. I don't think I have to remind you of the trouble that our families are in today. And sometimes people say, well, preacher, don't bring up negative stuff. Well, we live in a world that is full of that, unfortunately. And it's almost like we've kind of gone asleep, and the only way we're going to get woke up is to see the reality of it all. But sadly enough, our families are falling apart, and our families, their divorce rate is so high, and sadly enough, it almost seems like it just doesn't matter anymore. And people are choosing to live together rather than obey God and do it the right way. And it affects the family. I would to God that God would work in our hearts. You do name the name of Christ, don't you? I mean, is not God your God? And he hasn't changed in his word. And so yet our families are under attack, sadly enough. And now a lot of times it's just a single mom or a single dad that's having to raise families. And it just makes it that more difficult. And of course, our children are rebelling, and a lot of times children are doing their own thing, and it's almost so out of control. Families have a hole. You don't see families coming to church together to worship God like you used to. A lot of times it's just a mom coming, and not the dad. A lot of times it's the other way around. And sadly enough, something that I see that's more popular today, you know who's leading the family? It's the children leading the family. It's the children making the decision on where they go worship God. Which, by the way, folks, I think is a major mistake. Yeah, but Dad, I want to go there because they have more fun at this church, or they have more activities at this church, or it's the more popular church. And yet I sometimes wonder, where is the leadership of the family in picking a church that preaches the Word of God and that stands by the truth of God? That's more important. But today, that's not the case with a lot of families. And a lot of times, families, I'm not trying to step on toes, but the truth is, our families are in a major problem, and a lot of times, you know, everything is centered around the kids, and well, if we've got a ball game, we can't come to worship God, and there are periods of time where families can't worship God because they're out traveling, playing ball games, or whatever the case may be. Can I tell you something about this COVID situation? Well, I tell you, this COVID has shut everything down, hasn't it? Oh, it really has. It's shut down schools. it has shut down businesses and all that stuff. It has shut down even churches to where you can't attend any of this stuff. But you know what it did not shut down, nor couldn't shut down, and that is this: you doing what God would have you to do. You could still worship God. You can still serve the Lord. You can still pray to God. Just because you don't have a building to assemble in. But sadly enough, what this COVID has done, it has revealed what people really love and what they really want. It has revealed things like that. And I tell you, folks, we have got to get back to majoring on what God would have us to do when it comes to our families. I know, I understand, and I've mentioned it before, you know, during this COVID situation, alcohol's up, sales of alcohol. And I told you, I was standing in a business waiting on someone, and they were talking at the counter, and they didn't care who was listening. I was listening. And they were talking about him getting married, and he says, yeah, I've started drinking again because I just got married. Folks, that doesn't say much about a marriage. That in order to handle your wife, in order to be able to live with her, you got to drink. And of course, I don't know about you, but I've seen things online where this parent comes online and begins to beg the teachers, please take my kids back. Oh, I appreciate you teachers because of all the things you put up with. Obviously, there's been a lot of eye-opening thing there. But folks have been forced to be at home. And for I think for a lot of people it's been okay. But for others, it has not been very good. They've had to be around their kids more than they normally are. They've had to be around each other as far as husband and wife more than they normally are. They say that during this period of time, people, as far as medication has gone up, anxiety medication because of stress and all of those things. And obviously it has tested us for sure. This COVID situation. This morning, I want to encourage you concerning the family. Fellas, I want to talk to you today. You know, as we look at Joshua, and right quickly, let me just simply point this out to you that there are some things about Joshua that you, at least as you look at, you got to at least acknowledge he did. And I think are missing in men today. First of all, He was a leader in his home. In other words, he was willing to lead. He says, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Would to God that we had men that are willing to lead in their home. I'm not talking about being a dictator. But I am talking about a man that is willing to lead by example. And to follow a direction and to point in a direction and to live his life so that others can follow, to imitate, to follow as an example. We're missing that in our homes today. Amen. And Joshua, at least you have to acknowledge that he was a leader. But not only that, it was also personal to Joshua. In other words, he did it himself. Would to God that we would have men of God who loved God. And that they would not say, you do as I say, not as I do. I was raised that way. That's what my dad was very famous for saying. Do as I say, not as I do. Guess what I did? I did what he did. Thank God I didn't do it all, though. But I tell you, we need men today, fellas. We need men that are willing to be examples of God. Willing to be examples that are good examples in society, in our communities, in our churches. But that you can look at and say, you know what? I want to be like him. because they're doing what's right. Boy, I tell you, our homes need that. Our families need that. It's an old message, but it still is true today, and that is this. We are missing men. We're missing men in our families. We're missing men in our churches. Amen. Of course, please don't ask the question, because it will be embarrassing to answer it. Then what are the men doing? You don't want to know what they're doing. A lot of people already know what they're doing. They're living their lives themselves, for themselves. They're living their lives on what they want, no matter what happens. You see, when you get married, by the way, marriage is a contract between two people, right? I know. They're even trying to change that. But biblically speaking, it is a contract between two people who agree. We're going to be faithful. We make a covenant. We make a covenant between us and God and to each other. Amen. And they're not afraid to make a commitment, say, I'm going to be faithful to you. Amen, amen for that. It's sad. It's sad that today, a lot of times, two people, when they get married, they're very hesitant. Well, I don't know if I can be that faithful to you or not. We'll just see how it goes, okay? How would you like to commit your life to someone like that? Or maybe someone that, you know what, I don't really want to commit myself to you. I'm going to leave my options open. That's not marriage, by the way. And by the way, marriage is a divine thing. It is. Because it was designed, by God. And God is the one that knows how it works. And the way God set it up, it's a marriage that is motivated by love. Oh my goodness. Husbands, love your wife. Boy, that's the kind of men we need. Amen, preacher. Come on, ladies, you got to help me here. That's the kind of men that know how to love. But that's the problem today. Men today, they're not very good husbands. They're not very good family men. How come? Why are they missing in our families? Because the only one they know how to love is themselves. Amen. Fellas, you hear me? We got to change that. We got to learn to love God. Boy, if you're married, my goodness, there is no room for you to love just yourself. A marriage takes a commitment. A marriage takes, you think more of someone else than you do yourself. That's a marriage. And it's not easy. Takes a man to do that. Do you hear me? Takes a man to love like that. Anybody can love themselves. Stamp up to the plate, sir. That's what we're missing today. But Joshua, he not only was a leader, he led by example, by the way, but he also, it was personal. In other words, he loved God. He walked with God. Amen. This morning, I think it's time to start preaching. Three things I just want to remind you about today. Concerning our families and concerning decisions that need to be a part of our lives. Number one, What God will you serve? You see, I believe every man needs to decide that. Joshua challenges Israel and everyone is, choose you this day whom you will serve. And that is the question, isn't it? What God are you going to serve? What is it that because without a doubt, whoever you serve, that will then pretty much set everything else in motion. And I tell you, I challenge you without a doubt. We have opened the door that with men being absent from our families and men doing their own thing and not choosing God, it has opened the door to so many problems. You know, it's amazing to me how valuable a man is in a relationship. How important a man is when it comes to the daughter. By the way, I have one. But you don't realize how valuable. Some of you need to listen to what I'm saying. How that daddy treats his daughter. And how he treats her and protects her. Our homes are missing that. Because the husband is so full of himself and so bent and he doesn't want to serve God. And it spills over and it affects the daughter, it affects the wife. Husbands, love your wife like Christ loved the church, and yet we're missing that, and there's such doubt in the relationship because our men have decided not to serve God. Guys, we got to get back to it. We not only should choose to serve the Lord, but we ought to choose to serve God with all of our hearts. Amen. I don't know what it's going to take. I don't know what it's going to take to get our men attention. Buddy, some of you might say, well, I'm not your buddy. Well, deal with it, okay? I'm just telling you. I'm just trying to get your attention. I'm not your enemy. But it's time that you and I look at ourselves, and it's time that you and I step up to the plate and admit, I'm not doing what God would have me to do, and I'm not the man I ought to be. What God will you serve? I believe America as a whole has made a terrible decision. She has rejected God. And we will pay the price for it. We will. Next Sunday, we're going to show you a video that is a very informative video, but it's a very encouraging in the respect. I do believe it ends well, but it shows the reality of where we're at. I think it will help. But not only what God will you serve, and as we look at Joshua and as he as he encourages Israel and as he points them in the right direction, he says, "Hey, choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord." But secondly, what are you going to do with the Word of God? What are you going to do with it? This is personal. But I would dare say, if I were to ask a question this morning, are you saved? Probably every single one of us today would raise your hand and say, yes, I am. Right? Sure, you would. So let me ask you then. What are you going to do with this? According to the Word of God, according to what God says, every single step is ordered by His Word. That's the way it ought to be in our lives. You know, this is not just another book. It is the Word of God. It is the Word of God, by the way, that changes lives. Through the Spirit of God, it changes lives. But you and I have to make a decision on what are we going to do with it. Is it going to just sit on a shelf somewhere to collect dust? Are we going to carry it just simply for looks only? But are we going to live according to the statutes of this book? Every Monday through Friday in the morning, normally it's between 8 and 9, I do a little devotional. And for the past 2 weeks, I've been doing a devotional out of Psalm 119. You know what Psalm 119 is, don't you? Probably one of the shortest psalms of all, right? I know who I'm talking to. Oh, no. It's one of the longest. But Psalms 119 is a tribute to the Word of God. God's precious Word. And it lifts up and over and over and over and over again. It encourages you and I to love God and to love His Word and to walk in it. How shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. Boy, I love that verse. Still do. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. And so the question begs you and I to at least pay attention. And that is this. What are we going to do with the Word of God? We cannot ignore it. We've got to deal with it. It is our guide. It is our way to live by. It is what tells us about God. Oh, I can be religious and I can be what God would have me to be without God's word. I don't have to read it, and that's a lie. It is. Joshua said, "Choose you this day whom you will serve." Whether the gods of your fathers on the other side of the flood or the gods of the Amorite in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Can I tell you that's only possible if you obey God? Are there other gods that the world creates? Sure there is. Well, then how do I know the difference? How do you know that you know, this other group is not right, right? How do you know that the guy down on the corner or the lady up the street, how do you know that they're not, you know, right? You know how you know? This right here. This is how you know. Do you really think that it kind of stumps God? Did you know that in the Bible days, in Jesus' day, there were those that were actually quoting God's word in their defense? Even the devil quotes God's word. But it is the truth of God with the Spirit of God that leads and directs us. And boy, we need that today. We do. What are we going to do with God? What are we going to do with His Word? And then lastly, what are we going to do with prayer? Did you know it's interesting? Notice if you would in Joshua 24. Notice in verse number 16. The Bible says this, and the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For the Lord our God, it is He that brought us up and our fathers out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, and which did those great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the ways wherein we went and among all the people through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out from before us all the people, and it goes through all that. In verse 19, the Bible says this, though. And Joshua said unto the people, ye cannot serve the Lord. Whoa. In other words, I would dare say that sometimes we're just kind of like smoke and mirrors. In other words, we're just blowing smoke. Because we don't really have a clue what we're saying or even doing. And we have no intent of doing what's right. And Joshua calls them on him and say, you cannot serve the Lord. And he goes on and he says this. You cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. And he will not forgive your transgressions nor your sins. And I tell you, I believe today we have such a wrong idea of who God is today. Now God today is the man upstairs and he's our buddy. And we can do, and hey, we can even go and have a drink with God. We have lost who God is. And Joshua makes it quite plain. God is a holy God. There's no way you can even approach him. And all I'm saying is this, we've got to understand that our God is not what this world portrays him to be. But our God is what the Bible says he is. We need to get back to what the Bible says. As Joshua encourages Israel, he says, you cannot serve the Lord. He says, this is what you got to do in order to do what God would have. But one of the things that they do is they pray. And folks, I tell you today, if there's anything that every family has got to decide to do, make a choice on, it, is what are you going to do with prayer? Let me ask you, when's the last time you prayed? When's the last time you prayed for your family? And I would dare say that the numbers quickly decrease when I say this. Fellas, when's the last time you prayed? Hey, fellas, when's the last time you prayed for your wife? You fathers? When's the last time you prayed for their mother? When's the last time you prayed for your children? Do you think it would help if men would pray? Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Would to God that men today would get to the point where they're not proud, but they humble themselves under the mighty hand of God and they seek God's face. In other words, they learn to pray. They learn to be praying men. We need men to pray. We need men to pray for their families, their children, their spouses. We need men to pray for our church and our country. We need men to pray. When's the last time you gathered with your wife or your children and you prayed together? When's the last time that happened? You know, you can do that, you know. We live in a country today where you're allowed to do that. But we just don't do that like we once did. And why not? Why not pray? Why not pray together? Why not pray as a family? Personal prayer, yes. But family prayer. I don't have time to go into this, but let me tell you the value of a mom and dad showing the example of living in this world by prayer. Sharing prayer requests with the family and then praying for that prayer request. Children sharing their problems with mom and dad and mom and dad praying with the child right there. Where is that gone? Because I promise you, because what you and I practice at home, it is teaching our children. It is, fellas. You know, whether you like it or not, parents have a big influence on their children. I didn't say what kind of influence. I'm just telling you they have. Whether you like it or not, our children will probably wind up like us. Is that good or bad? That's your call. How we handle problems. How we deal with situations. It was Joshua who stood before no doubt a crowd of people. These were not just any people. These were leaders of different groups in Israel. And he challenges them. He challenges them concerning God. Choose you this day. Fellas, I challenge you today. Choose who you're going to serve. I pray that you get off the throne and God gets on the throne of your life. That it is God that you serve. It is God that you choose. I also pray, fellas, that this book becomes our guide. That we eat up this book. That we live by this book. That men today are not driven by the culture and whatever is politically correct. But we are driven by what thus saith the Lord. I also challenge you men. We're not too proud to humble ourselves. We're not too proud to bow a knee. And to take our request to God. I challenge you fellas to become prayer warriors. Why? Because without a doubt, there is an absence of the Father in the home. Our families are falling apart. Would to God. That men would rise up and be what they ought to be before God. That men would be good examples for others to follow. I challenge you, fellas. Would you bow your head, please? Every head bowed, every eye closed. As our panelist comes and another. Song leader comes. The challenge today is to our families, but in particular our fathers, our men. If I have made you mad, of course that was not my intent, but that's not your problem. Your problem is to do business with God. So today, while you're sitting there in your pew, every head bowed and every eye closed, our pianist begins to play. Would you, as a man, would you be willing to be the man God would have you to be? You can't do it yourself, but God can help you. Would you be willing? Say, preacher, I haven't been what God would have me to be. I know that. Would you pray for me? You might say by an uplifted hand, preacher, would you just pray for me? Any man like that, God bless you. Thank you. I see that hand. Preacher, I have not been the man that I ought to be. God's convicted my heart. God's been working in my life. Would you just pray for me? Would you add me in that prayer? Anyone else? God bless you. Fellas, I tell you, our homes is a mess. And the direction our country is going, you as a man, you can affect that. What about it? Oh, I tell you, one of the best places to start is with God. Some of you here this morning, you might not be saved. God's knocking at your heart's door. Maybe it reveals to you your need of a Savior. If that is the case, won't you seek me out after the service this morning? Right now in the pew, could you do business with God? Would you do business? Would you pray for your family, even right now? Our Father, Lord, we've had some men. My hand is raised. Because, Father, as a man, I need your help. The responsibility that is given to me as a dad and as a husband, Lord, I cannot do it without you. And Lord, to love like I ought to love, Lord, I need your help. Help me to be the example. Help me to be the leader that I ought to be. But I pray for every single man here, Lord, that you would do a work in their heart and they would realize their responsibility. They would step up to the plate, be strong, and have good courage. Lord, bless our homes. May there be a revival of going back to you. Please, Lord. Have your will and way today, I pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Would you join with Dave as he leads us in a song? Just lift up your voice together. Come on, as we sing. That's the way it ought to be. Have thine own way. It should always be that. Have thine own way, Lord. Today and glad that you were able to come. For our fathers today, we do have a gift for you. And so out as you go out, there'll be those there at the door that will give you your gift. And I think it has something to do with you are our knight in shining armor. You'll have to figure all that out, all right? So let's all stand. This morning, good to have you today in the house of the Lord. We will go live at 6 o'clock this evening. And so please join with us online and looking forward to that service as well. All right. And then, of course, on Wednesday, we go live at 7. So be mindful of that. Okay. God bless you today. You are dismissed. Thank you.